So any ideas?
Do you know any other criterions for the compactness of metric spaces?
Mm-hmm.
Like we can check sequence compactness, maybe.
That's right, sequential. Mm-hmm.
It's for metric spaces.
Mm-hmm. So, what sequence would we? So, how do we start?
So we have a sequence of elements with norm like OS equal one.
Uh-huh. Okay, so we have a I,
and we should take a fundamental subsequence. Maybe it would be obvious from non-Archimedean property, let me think.
So, okay, so let's consider expansions maybe of this. Then what can we say?
May I propose something else? Do you know about the criterion involving epsilon nets?
Like exists finite epsilon net.
For any epsilon, there is a finite epsilon net. Is it possible to prove this for all sub V? Maybe this will be easier than dealing.
Yes. So of course, it follows from a non-Archimedean thing that we can consider just like if you want distance for any point of net to our element be less than epsilon.
Do you want to try writing it down, maybe? Because for now, what I'm proposing, right, is I was thinking of just taking the expansion of each of these numbers, right? And then applying a pigeonhole principle.
What you want to consider?
I wanted
extension.
To...
Extension?
Yes.
What it mean?
Expansion, not extension.
Expansion, yes.
Expansion. What is expansion?
So you can choose a uniformizing element pi, and then any element of O sub V will be a series of the form, say AI multiplied by pi to the I. Okay.
AI
is some finite set of representatives of the factor OV over pi.
It's always so we can write down each AI.
You can even
what
is the problem further. You can reduce the problem even further. You can see that O sub V is actually a finite rank module of periodic numbers of the right. Sub P, right?
So it would be enough for just Z sub P.
Sorry, I have a question. This set is elements with norm less or equal to one, yes? And if we take a sequence such that all elements are different and it has no elements in the origin of zero. So it's appear that if we could take a Cauchy subsequence, it will be not possible because the norm of the difference must be equal of the norm of one of elements of this difference.
This is completely false.
Why?
Take for example Z sub P. You can take say one and P plus one. Norms of one and P plus one both equal to one, right? And the norm of the difference is smaller than one.
Also, we should have a condition that the norm of each element of the sequence we consider are different.
So if the norms are different,
mm-hmm.
then they will converge to zero,
okay,
right?
Okay, so thank you.
So once again, we reduced everything to the statement that Z sub P is compact. Can you prove that Z sub P is compact? This statement is of course very essential to all the considerations from today's lecture because we used the compactness of O sub V several times in very crucial ways.
Sorry, and does this gives us some sort of solution? So if we have a sequence which tends to zero, it is a Cauchy sequence. Otherwise,
any sequence.
Okay, sorry.
Tends to anything,
and otherwise, we sequence. Should have infinite subsequence of elements of the same norm.
And this is very possible once again, right?
Mm-hmm.
And so?
We want to prove it, sorry.
So if you have a sequence or of the element with the same norm, what will happen? I think nothing terrible will happen about this, right?
So what can we say about the first digit? How many elements is the same first digit do we have in the periodic expansion?
I think B.
What's that?
What?
Well, could you repeat your question?
So in the periodic expansion, how many elements do we have with the same first digit?
I don't get it.
Infinite number.
As many as you want.
That's maybe right. Infinitely many. So how many among those will have the same second digit?
So I think we can find a subsequence in ZP, which is Cauchy, but we have maybe more general statement.
What more general statement?
We have not. We have K and.
Once again, it's enough to prove everything for Z sub P, because O sub V is a free module of finite rank over Z sub P, correct?
Okay. So for Z sub P, it is obvious.
What's that? For Z sub P, it's obvious?
Yes, because we, first of all, we find a infinite subsequence with the same first digit, after that with the same second, etc. And after that we use, I don't know, it's maybe we can call it counter trick. So we construct Cauchy subsequence.
Excuse me. Why there will be infinitely many sequences with same first digit?
Because there are only finitely many possibilities for the
yes, because it's ZP.
Mm-hmm. So okay, does everybody understand?
And topology is defined like, so the sequence will converge if it converges like per number, yeah?
What?
If our sequence of numbers in ZP stabilizes in each coordinate, then the sequence will converge to something.
Yes, the definition, because you have a metric on your Z sub P.
And I can just calculate.
So okay, we concluded that O sub V is actually always compact.
Mm-hmm.
Which is nice to know, because we use compactness everywhere.
All right.
So the second,
yes,
the second problem.
So you have V1.
The second problem is also a useful statement from the lecture.
Mm-hmm. V1, V2.
We have two different norms on.
Yeah.
Okay.
Uh-huh.
We would like to prove that there is an element which is larger than one in the first norm and smaller than one in the second norm. This is the base of induction in the proof of the weak approximation theorem.
like we can just take any two events with different norms and normalize, no? It's not vector spaces, of course.
What is not vector space? What are you saying?
This norm is not a norm on vector space, so we can't like multiply it by some rational
number. There are two different norms and the single element. So, you mean that the norm is not surjective, right?
It is, for example.
I mean that the norm does not necessarily attain all the possible values. All the real values, right? There are examples of norms that can only be powers of p, for example. So you can't just normalize. Or can you? what was your proposed solution?
It's
false.
My argument was kind of, it's a norm, so we can like multiply our element by something and change its norm, but it's
we can, but
results will be unexpected.
These norms will give you different coefficients when you multiply alpha by something.
So, can we just consider cases like when alpha is non-Archimedean, then it corresponds to some
prime ideal? Welcome to consider cases.
So these two norms corresponds to different ideals, for example.
So what are the cases you would like to you would like to consider here?
Archimedean and non-Archimedean for.
So there are essentially four different cases, right?
Free without loss of generality.
Of course, you can always replace alpha by alpha to the minus one. So either both norms are non-Archimedean, and in this case, what can you do? If both norms are non-Archimedean.
Like, maybe we should consider ideals.
So let we both V1 and V2 be non-Archimedean norms. Consider the corresponding ideals P and Q. You, for example, what can you do next?
I forgot how ideal and norm correspondence work.
So can someone please explain how the correspondence between non-Archimedean norms and ideals work?
Like it counts valuation, I remember. Yeah.
Yeah.
Of a principal ideal generated by our element. So we want two valuation be positive for one element and negative for our element, for other element. Mm-hmm. Yes.
Yeah.
It just, for example, we can take an element that is like if these two ideals are prime.
What do you mean?
if they are unnecessarily prime.
I mean, not if, but since they like if they are not containing each other, then we can just take element like p small divided by q small.
What do you mean? These two ideals are not necessarily not necessarily principal, right?
Yes. So
if they are prime take... and principal, then that's easy. And what if they are not?
Imagine situation: we have some prime ideal and element of it. Then what will be evaluation of this element of ideal generated by this element and this prime ideal?
There are different possibilities for this.
Different possibilities. So
if you take Q and you take an ideal generated by say two, then both 4 and 2 lie in this ideal, and the valuations are 2 and 1.
Yes, but I need only the fact that it's positive.
Okay, so take an element that lies in the first ideal.
And now take the element that lies in second ideal, but not in first ideal, without loss of generality. Yeah?
Uh-huh.
And divide to some big power of it.
Why do you need to take a power?
Because maybe first element was has some
correlation
of our thing. Yeah.
Correct.
So our idea may be nested, but one of them has points that don't belong to either.
Yeah. So this is the complete proof for the case of two non-Archimedean norms.
Yeah, but for Archimedean norms, I think for one Archimedean and one non-Archimedean, we can take any point with like non-Archimedean norm less than one. And then just, I have remembered how non-Archimedean norms work, like they kind of count relation. And what does our Archimedean norm do?
Archimedean norm is when you is when you embed your K into complex numbers, and it inherits the norm from complex numbers.
Yeah, but and I can just multiply by integers, by the way. We have some prime ideal that like lies over some prime, and we will just take an element of one over it.
So what are we trying to prove right now?
We are trying to prove that there is an element with non-Archimedean norm less than one and this Archimedean norm greater than one.
Uh-huh.
So we are taking like one over element of prime ideal, and then multiplying this by prime that don't belong to our ideal multiple times to get an
norm. Non-Archimedean norm will be large, not small. We want to
know. Because the evaluation has negative signs, then we are taking element from our ideal, getting small. Getting small non-Archimedean norm and then just increasing our element by multiplying by a new prime number that don't belong to our ideal, so decompose to other prime ideals. Yeah. I think that I don't believe myself, because really I don't understand my own proof of part one.
Sorry, because... I have a stupid question. Sorry. BK, is it an extension of rational numbers?
That's right.
Yes, it's a number field.
So it is enough to prove it's for rational numbers?
Why? You see, you want to prove something about norms on K. How do you relate norms on K and norms on rational numbers? For example, two different norms on K can give you equal norms on rational numbers.
So I figured out what I should say. So again, we are taking element of our ideal that has non-Archimedean relation sum, and then multiply this by prime number, rational prime number.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and my idea that it wouldn't change relation if this prime number is new, which means don't belong to this ideal.
Yeah, but it will increase the Archimedean norm.
Yes, and that's exactly what we need.
Okay. And but, the last part is when you have two different Archimedean norms.
I need to understand what exactly I used for things that I said. Like, I definitely used that relation of product is sum of relations, and that relation of numbers that don't belong to our ideal.
And you also used that Archimedean norm of any rational prime is greater than one.
Yes, but yes, and my question is, if element don't belong to ideal, then its relation, because our prime ideal can't contain some strange ideas. Yes, sorry, it's first time when I think about this, so.
Yeah, that's precisely why we need seminars, so that's okay.
Totally agree. Okay, and if we have two Archimedean norms, it means that we have two different embeddings.
Mm-hmm.
And we need to find the element that maps into unit circle, but with one embedding, but not into unit circle with other embedding. So can we think about K, we have a subfield? Subfield of K generated by single element which will have two other embeddings. Yeah. So we can think of K Q of some alpha.
Yeah. Of course, K is always generated by single element by the primitive element theorem. So what is your point now?
No. by some radical, square root of or cube root, I can't say that.
No, it's not necessarily true.
Right.
Yeah.
So, for example, you can take a Galois cubic extension of Q, then it has no radical subfields at all.
No radical subfields at all. Okay. So how to think about arbitrary embeddings in that case? It's easy. We have just what we really need is element with different norms. We need to prove a fact if two embeddings in composition with norm are same, then they are same. Yeah.
If two embeddings give a different norm, if two embeddings give the same norm, they are equal. That would be my question to you.
By the way, they can be conjugated, but we.
Yes, if they are conjugated, then they give the same element of the canonic set.
Yes. Now we know that we have like two embeddings of number field that are like that generates same. I think it's some tautology. I mean, we don't need to prove this because the norms are different. We can just say that it's obvious because we can like take any two elements that they are different and then like multiply by something.
By what?
They will.
So suppose we have some alpha such that. The first norm of alpha is say less than the second norm.
Multiply by geometric mean inverse of these norms.
But this geometric mean does not necessarily lie in your field, right?
Yes. Multiplying by what? We need our field to have an element between these norms. Of what I am saying.
We need an element with norm.
Maybe we need element.
A rational number between it which is.
Please, someone write something. Because if you don't write it, we will get completely lost, I guess.
I'm sorry. And what's the case now? We have two norms. We
have two Archimedean norms. And we have one element alpha. Such that the first norm is less than the second norm. We need to somehow cook up the element with the desired condition from the.
And, if from we the restrict top. This norm to rational numbers, would we have the same norm?
Answer this question yourself, please.
I think it is.
Yes.
There is only one Archimedean norm.
Sorry?
There is only one Archimedean norm on rational.
So we can take a rational number between these two norms and divide?
Yeah, for sure.
Excuse me, but it's not obvious that restriction of an Archimedean norm is Archimedean because Archimedean is a negative property.
Okay.
You see, if the restriction of your Archimedean norm to rational numbers is non-Archimedean, then you can easily prove that the extension of this norm into the whole field is also non-Archimedean. We already discussed the extensions of norms. The extension of any non-Archimedean norm is still non-Archimedean.
Okay.
So, okay, this resolves the second question. So what about the third one?
The third problem. Mm-hmm.
The third problem, yeah.
Yeah. 1 second, I have to restart the demonstration because the 40 minutes.
Okay.
Yes, 1 second. Mm-hmm.